The first honor I have is to introduce Isolde Borghese. Now, I met her a number of years ago in Cologne, and every time I told people that I often come to Bonn and Cologne and this area of Germany, they told me, "Oh, you must meet Professor Borghese." And eventually I did. I called her, and I knew this. Some of the speakers here had told me about her. And there's something very interesting. She studied Romance linguistics at the university and has her PhD in that area. And she came to take an interest in the relationship between the linguistics that she knew and taught and legal interpretation. And as a result, she started working on the relationship between the two. And at the same time, wrote her habilitation on the relationship between the two in Europe, and just by virtue of sheer knowledge and perseverance, really became, I would think, the leading scholar in Germany and one of the very leading scholars in Europe in the relationship between language and law, but in the field of legal linguistics, a field that I'll say later we don't have in the United States. We don't call it that. And I don't think most Europeans would want us taking that name because they don't like what we're doing over there. So so we have some, there's nothing that I respect more than somebody who teaches herself something that nobody's doing but she thinks is interesting and then makes a field of it and becomes a leader in that field. It's just the most admirable way for intellectual development to occur. And now we can hear from her directly. So I introduce Isolde Borghese.
Thank you very much. I was too much honored, and therefore a little bit I cannot answer really, because I was I'm very grateful to you all to be here, also to meet old friends. Gave a big support for all the things in legal linguistics, and was also the enthusiasm, which is the main thing when you have to promote things. Now I'm very happy also Jan Engberg gives the subject with the allusion to the European Court of Justice. There's no the bridge to my subject, the Charter of EU Fundamental Rights, Problems of Interpretation from a Comparative Perspective. Official multilingualism plays a crucial role in the interpretation in the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. Official multilingualism has existed at the national level since the 19th century in particular. Examples include countries as Belgium, Switzerland, Finland and Canada. Unlike official multilingualism at national level, official multilingualism in the EU is not bound to a uniform legal culture. As a result of this, the genesis of EU legal texts is always exposed to the tension between the linguistic process of translation and legal comparison in order to create equally authentic versions. In the respect, the link between language and law is inseparable in the EU context. This fact determines the interpretation of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. Voilà. Mm-hmm. Wait a minute, it's coming. No, I'm continuing to the history. For a comparative approach to the interpretation of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights, it is first necessary to recall its history. The proclamation of the Charter in 2000 was a start into a new era in the history of European fundamental rights. At that time, the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights was binding in 12 language versions. With the entry into force to the Lisbon Treaty in 2009, pursuant to Article 6.1 TU, the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights became an integral part of EU primary law alongside the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, TFEU, and the Treaty on European Union. voilà. Yeah. Here we have the famous article in 6.1 of the TU that the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights became an integral part of EU primary law. The Union recognized the rights, freedoms and principles set out in the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union of 7 December 2000 as adopted in Strasbourg on 12 December 2007, which shall have the same legal value as the treaties. Hence, Article 55 DU is not only applicable to the TFEU, but also to the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. Here we have the text of the famous Article 55, which is in a long, long tradition coming from the Roman treaties, but nevertheless always there was no together with the other languages. And here the treaty drawn up in a single original, and now all the scala of languages from today, but it's very important, and that's coming from the Roman treaties. The text in each of these languages be equally authentic. That's the main aim in this, and you will continue, I think, in your presentation also to refer to this article. As a result of the various stages of EU enlargement, the number of official EU languages has now doubled. This means that 24 language versions of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights are now available, which have equal status and thus also have the same formal legal force. All 24 languages versions of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights are equally authentic. The binding linguistic diversity represents a great opportunity for European citizens in terms of knowledge and respect for their individual rights. This official multilingualism considerably reduce the language barrier for each EU citizen. However, this does not mean that the guarantee of multilingualism leads to the complete elimination of the language barrier. It should be noted that the possibility of access to different but equal authentic language versions does not mean that the addressee always captures the represented legal concepts in the sense of European law, despite the consolidation of the legal text version in a language known to him or her. For a reason of illustration, please allow me to make a brief digression to relevant approaches of linguistics in this context. In general, text comprehension processes are a complex cognitive process. Concepts are considered elementary units of cognition. On the cognitive level, concepts represent the component that determine the semantic content of an expression. Therefore, a concept for an expression can also be described in German as Begriff. Depending on the context, a concept consists of different elements. Thus, one and the same linguistic expression can have several concepts. Ideally, only the concept of the expression that was meant by the use of the expression in the concrete context is represented cognitively. Achieving this ideal is really important in the multilingual drafting of fundamental rights. As a basic principle, fundamental rights always reflect values and thus also a certain understanding of cultural law. This means that certain concepts for certain expressions, such as the right to liberty, already exist on the cognitive level, which are automatically mapped by perceiving the expression. In this respect, some principles should be respected in the process of understanding the fundamental rights of the Charter and also in its interpretation in order to grasp the concept of European Union law. After these brief linguistic remarks, I now come back to the setting in which the Charter was drawn up. The idea of creating a separate national community of values at EU level, guided by drafting of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. But this idea limits where the core of national identity and thus national values have been affected. The preamble of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights is an example for this. French legal culture would not have allowed the expression religieux to be used instead of spiritual. You know, the famous, and also in a real battle, which was there about this idea, if we can integrate in the mind of Invocatio Dei this idea of religieux in German, yes. And I remember that Herzog wrote in one article, it was necessary to need 3 days to understand why religieux and religieux in German and French are quite different. Otherwise, the core of French legal culture, secularism, would have been affected. This multilingual exchange about national values was possible in the basis of convention method, in German, Konventsmethode, which has been further developed here. Throughout the drafting of the charter, the meetings of the convention were open to the public. This enabled a continuous exchange between the delegates and the committee of the convention as well as civil society. In this way, two important aspects could already be taken into account in the genesis of the Charter: linguistic and cultural diversity and the equally authentic character of all language versions at the same time. The approach to the genesis of EU Charter of Fundamental Rights in the form of the convention method makes it clear once again that the drafting of the language versions of the EU Charter is not a translation process in the classical sense. It shows that the legal concepts intended by the EU Charter had to be reviewed linguistically equivalent. It is remarkable that due to the convention method, the cognitive process linked to understanding the charter have already been articulated transparently at the level of text production. In other words, the actors involved have identified the following aspects in constant exchange. First, which national understanding of fundamental rights already existed? Second, what kind of understanding at union level could be created by the charter? Third, and how this should be realized linguistically so that the meaning of the EU concept of fundamental rights is also recognized at national level. The better this has been taken into account during the Charter's genesis, the less cognitive linguistic problems will emerge later in the process of understanding the Charter and thus in its interpretation. The second part of the presentation, we deal with a question. I don't know if the, yeah, just now I'm coming to the principles in interpretation. And now the second part of the presentation will deal with a question of the possibilities offered by legal linguistics and comparative approach to the interpretation of the Charter. The factors mentioned in the first part determine the comparative interpretation of the EU Charter is subject to certain principles. Some important principles will be discussed in the following section. Firstly, dynamic correspondence plays a leading role in the interpretation of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. Legal texts that have an equivalent correlation can build up correspondence among themselves. This means that there is dynamic interaction between the language versions. Through the process of interaction, a common meaning and thus equivalence is constituted. This constitution is a complex cognitive process. The interpretation of the EU Charter shows that such a process of interaction does not only take place at one level. Rather, it is also an interplay between national legal understanding and legal understanding at European level. Furthermore, dynamic correspondence is closely linked to another principle. This is of cognitive nature. Multilingual comparative interpretation is always linked to language-specific knowledge. Language-specific knowledge includes lexical, syntactic or pragmatic knowledge of the respective language. This knowledge is individually determined from language to language. After all, language is also an elementary part of culture. There is no EU language of its own, but 24 official languages are legally recognized in the EU. In this respect, the first step in the comparative interpretation of the EU Charter is that the recipient activates the knowledge which he associates with this expression or the expressions mentioned in the language version consolidated by him. As a rule, the activated knowledge is initially linked to legal understanding at national level. The following example will clarify the interaction between the legal concepts EU, national legal concept also in the other side. Now the example. I present an example, Article 7 of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. We have here, or you can read it, jede Person hat das Recht auf Achtung ihres Privat- und Familienlebens, ihrer Wohnung sowie ihrer Kommunikation. Everyone has the right to respect for his or her private and family life, home and communications. Article 7 of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights concerned with the protection of private and family life. This article was literally taken from the European Convention on Human Rights from 1950, namely from the Article 8 with a small amendment. This amendment, this amendment concerns the exchange of the noun correspondence by the noun communications. This amendment has been implemented in all language versions. It is due to the fact that the expression correspondence and its equivalence in the other language versions and translation of the European Convention of Human Rights are semantically narrower than the concept of the expression communications. The expression communications take better account of digital progress and the possibilities associated with it. At the same time, it opens up a further scope of protection than correspondence. Since all language versions of Article 7 of the EU Charter have been harmonized in this point, there is no legal linguistic problem here. However, there's a problem regarding to the expression family life. On the level of meaning, the expression family is strongly influenced by cultural ideas, especially values. In this respect, reading Article 7 of the EU Charter, the recipient will ask himself which concept of family is meant, regardless to which language version he consolidates. For the following consideration, we assume a German recipient who consolidates the German version. First, he will evoke the knowledge framework to the expression family. Due to the fact that the chart is a legal text, only a certain concept of family is cognitively represented for the recipient. This particular concept of family is the knowledge framework on how family is legally understood at the national level in Germany. In this regard, the concept of family within the meaning of Article 6, 6.1, Basic Law for the Federal Republic. The second part, the marriage and the family shall enjoy the special protection of the state. Nevertheless, the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights is a supranational legal text. That is why the recipient must ask himself in the next step whether his national concept matches that of the EU. These remarks describe the first phase of dynamic correspondence. Based on the perception of the expression the EU Charter, the recipient refers to a national concept in the process of understanding. It is undisputed from a legal point of view that the concept of family covered by Article 7 of the Charter must at least contain the scope of protection of Article 6.1 of the German Basic Law as a subset. But this does not mean that the legal concept of family within the meaning of Article 6.1 of the German law can still be transferred to Article 7 of the Charter. This is where the next phase of it in the dynamic correspondence progress begins. This phase represents the dynamic interaction of the language versions of Article 7 of the EU Charter in order to work out of a common and thus European legal understanding of family life. A comparison with the English and French versions shows that the expression family life and vie familiale were used. Starting from the linguistic level, this does not allow conclusion to be drawn about a common concept. A comparison between the knowledge framework of this expression according to their respective national legal understanding would also not show a clear common concept of family life in the sense of the Charter. In this way, only a new concept of family could be drawn up whose knowledge framework has a component, the intersection of national concepts. But that would be a mere possibility. There's also the option that the expression family life in the Charter means, for example, more the French than the German legal concepts of family. At the same time, there is the option that the concept has further components beyond the intersection. This ambiguity is illustrated by the following passage from a discussion in the convention. It was well, here we have here the minutes of session to the Charter, and there was preparing for further Article 8. Just the representative from Netherlands, Herr Spalin, he asked which concept is meant by the expression family. And he continued that there was no evidence whether this expression also refers to same-sex couples or polygamous relationships. Herzog, the president of this convent, said that according to the regulation, family means that a child is living with at least one adult. This definition also included single parents and foster families. We have the background of the German interpretation. The Dutch version and asked questions are quite further. This large number of alternatives only disappears with a view to the Dutch language version. In the Dutch now of the version, the expressions Familie in Gesinsleben are used for the expression family life. With reference to the strategy of parallelization, one could first assume that is a divergence. Then in the Dutch version, the scope of protection of Article 7 of the Charter would be extended inadmissibly in contrast to the other versions. In fact, is the case that the concept of family life under the EU Charter is more liberal than the concept with the meaning Article 6.1 of the German Basic Law. Dutch Familie, here we have Dutch Familie stands for the classical kinship relationships over the several generation as well as degrees of kinship. The expression Gezin refers to the family nucleus whose core component are emotional and social bonds. As a result of this, the concept of this expression is more flexible for alternative forms of family life. Because of the equivalence of all language versions, the German version must therefore also be understood in a way that goes beyond the traditional protection of the small family and, for example, also makes the social bond of grandparents and grandchildren subject to the protection of fundamental rights. This may even lead to the creation of autonomous legal terms which are largely separate from a specific national legal concept. It should be noted in this context that a possible extension of the meaning at EU level in the form of autonomous EU legal terms is fully possible from a purely linguistic point of view, but it has its limits in the legal scope. This makes it clear once again that language and law must always be considered in conjunction by interpreting the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. The described processes for dynamic correspondence also take place with the judges and advocates general at the European Court of Justice during the decision-making process when it comes to the interpretation of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. It should be noted that this often finds its limits, unfortunately, on the premise of intent and purpose. At this point, it should be mentioned that dynamic correspondence over two levels can even be reciprocal. In any case, it takes place through the natural cognitive and understanding process from the national level to the union level. However, as the latest developments in German marriage and family law last year with regard to same-sex relationships have shown, dynamic correspondence can even have a retroactive effect at the national level in a second step. In this case, the comparative interpretation of the EU Charter influences a change of the legal concept of family at national level. It is remarkable that there was also dynamic correspondence during the drafting of the title of the Charter. The German legal expression Grundrechte appears to have been the origin of the expression fundamental rights in the case law of the Court of Justice. Just in the famous case of Stauder Stadt Ulm, there is its use in the title of the EU Charter suggests that the phrase fundamental rights is intended as a catch-all term, encompassing not only the classic universal guarantees of freedom from inference by the state, but also the right to participation in certain aspects of political, social, and economic life, and certain rights restricted only to citizens of the Union. The factor of language-specific knowledge is also relevant as an independent principle for the interpretation of EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. A higher degree of standardization and thus better comprehensibility can be achieved by parallelizing the language versions, strategy of parallelization. However, this does not always have to be the case. When drafting equally authentic language versions, language-specific conventions must always be respected. These conventions usually have a cultural origin. We have here different, on the Article 6, freedoms, right to liberty and security, Freiheiten, Recht auf Freiheit, Liberté, droit à la liberté, à la sûreté, Libertades, derecho a la libertad y la seguridad. Even if headings are generally not legally binding, you can detect that the limit of parallelization is a criterion for interpretation. When comparing the language versions, we see that unlike the other language versions, in the English version, the expression freedoms used in the title differs from the expression liberty in the regulatory text. Assuming a fully applicable strategy of parallelization, it could be concluded there is a divergence between the English version and the other language versions. However, this can only be proved by taking into account the language-specific convention in English. The expression liberty describes an abstract concept which to a certain extent is also shaped by individual and in English. The expression liberty describes an abstract concept which to a certain extent is also shaped by individual and philosophical ideas. Whereas the expression freedom usually requires a direct reference word, freedom of expression, freedom of employment, etc. In addition, in contrast to the noun liberty, the term freedom can also refer to legal persons. The full application of the parallelization strategy would have made the English version less comprehensible if it would not have complied with a language-specific convention. This example shows that the respect for language-specific convention is the limit of the strategy of parallelization. Otherwise, the overarching objective of equivalence would not be achieved. The strategy of parallelization does not always lead to equivalence. This can be seen in the following example. Article 3 of the Charter, in German, all the text, im Rahmen der Medizin und der Biologie muss insbesondere Folgendes beachtet werden. Die freie Einwilligung der Betroffenen nach vorheriger Aufklärung entsprechend den gesetzlich festgelegten Einzelheiten. English, the free and informed consent of the person concerned according to the procedure laid down by law. You can continue the other versions. The right to respect physical and mental integrity is the object of Article 3 of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. The English and Spanish versions use the adjective informed and informado respectively, whereas in the French version the adjective éclairé and the German version the expression nach vorheriger Aufklärung is used. If one only insisted on parallelization, then the question arises why the adjective informed was not used in all four language versions. This is for the following reason. In the medical biological context, it is important that the connection details are explained to the person concerned. This person should not only receive a flyer, for example, and then read the correlation and details themselves. In contrast to the German adjective informiert, the expression informed and informado can realize the concept of informed as well as the concept of after prior clarification. There is no divergence between the language versions because of the two expressions, Article 3 and 2 of the Charter, have the same meaning nach vorheriger Aufklärung due to their context. The using of the construction nach vorheriger Aufklärung instead of die freiwillige Einwilligung des aufgeklärten Betroffenen in the German version is also determined language specifically. In a German legal text, the expression aufgeklärter Betroffener is unusual. If you now took a look to the Romanian version, which was created at a later date than the other versions, accession was in 2004, and therefore it's after it was 2007. This was after the Treaty of Lisbon. You will find the expression here in also unconsumentense lieber schi in conoscenze de causa. Al possane interessati in conformità o possedo duride prevalse de legge. In constantinte de causa here, this means a war of the facts, informed of the facts, in Kenntnis der Sachlage, über die Sachlage informiert. In the Romanian version, it is therefore not clear that the information must firstly be clarified by a third party. It is also questionable whether Romanian medical law was so far developed at that time of writing the Roman version that from the national perspective, in conscience, de causa was to be understood in this context exclusively after prior clarification of vorheriger Aufklärung. Under this circumstance, this apparent divergence would already be eliminated due to the context. Otherwise, equivalence would only be achieved via the language comparison of the version. The Romanian version, which was not written under the convention method, shows that the linguistic process is a translation. But the legal linguistic process poses is the drafting of an equally authentic version. This principle applies not only to the language versions of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights, which were drafted after its entry into force, like the Croatian version, but generally to the interpretation of legal acts such as directives. Finally, another principle should be taken into account. The interpretation of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights is temporal dynamic. As has already been pointed out in the chapter of dynamic correspondence, the interpretation of the EU Charter can also influence the understanding of national fundamental rights. At the same time, however, it's also subject to cultural change over time. Fundamental rights are written in an abstract language because of their legal nature. Therefore, cultural values form the central starting point of interpretation. These values can change because they are part of culture, and culture is also a dynamic system. The European Convention of Human Rights has already shown that this dynamic process starts automatically over time. For example, the interpretation of the expression family life in Article 8, European Convention of Human Rights was also subject to cultural change. Since a considerable number of contracting states now legally recognize same-sex relationships, the European Court of Human Rights now considers it artificial not to classify these relationships as family life as well. The stable relationship of same-sex couples is now also part of the concept of family life in the European Convention of Human Rights. Consequently, the concept of family life in the EU Convention today is no longer the same concept at the time of the entry into force of the European Convention of Human Rights. In this respect, any comparative interpretation of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights must also take into account whether the respective fundamental rights has undergone a change in concept. In this respect, the following principles for the interpretation of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights can be established. First, the language versions of the Charter correspond dynamically to each other, dynamic correspondence. Second, multilingual comparative interpretation is always linked to language-specific knowledge. Third, the overall objective of the language versions is equivalence, namely equal authentic versions. Fourth, the interpretation of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights is also subject to changes in the understanding of culture and values. Now, the principles presented are applicable to all EU legal texts, in particular to directives and regulations. The analysis and application of these principles from the core of the work of European linguistics. On the one hand, the examination of these cognitive linguistic aspects enables the interpretation of EU legal texts such as the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. On the other hand, this principle should already be taken into account in the genesis of EU legal text in order to prevent problems of interpretation at a later stage. It would also make EU legal texts more comprehensible and, above all, more unambiguous for the agency with regard to the linguistic implementation of legal concepts. This would contribute to a further reduction of language barriers in the understanding process. Now, for law and culture, this is from Konkret Kunst, the idea of, it was first entitled, legal law, linguistic, legal linguistics. And now I can say thank you for your attention.